it's a nice day outside, and the Dalai Lama film was showing, so I think a lot of the audience is there. Welcome, and I want to first just welcome our panelists. Thank you all for taking the time to be here. We have Tenzin Dasel, who's a Tibetan exile who lives in Paris. She's come with a film called Royal Café. Pimpaka Towira is from Thailand. Her film was The Island Funeral. We have Rokhsareh Ghaemmaghami, who's from Iran, and she made a Sonita documentary. And on my left is Junfeng from Singapore, director of Apprentice. And next to him is Kiwi Chow Kwun-Wai from Hong Kong, who's one of the directors of 10 years. So welcome all of you. It's nice to have such a range of people gathered here. So the topic of our discussion today is invisible people. And the reason why I thought that this was an appropriate topic to talk about, even though I know that Junfeng might, his film might not quite fit in with the subject, but I'm sure you still have lots to say about it, is as a Tibetan exile myself, questions of identity, of being a refugee, being a minority in different countries, questions of nationality, who are you, where do you belong? These are questions that I've been kind of grappling with all my life, in a sense. So it's interesting that in these films that these filmmakers have made, somehow or the other they touch upon these issues. And so I thought it would be interesting to just hear from each one of you where you were coming from when you made your films that deal with these issues in one way or another. So can I ask maybe Dasel, since you're in that corner, to talk a little bit about, your film is very much about Tibetan migrants living in Paris. And this is a question that's obviously, nowadays it's such a big topic, right? So can you tell us why you decided to make your film? What were you hoping to talk about when you made that film?
Well, I did my first film called Scenes, which was shot in Delhi, India, and it was also based on Tibetan young people and how they think. And I think I really wanted to take it further and, from since I'm a migrant myself in Paris as a Tibetan, and like Tenzin himself, I also questioned all of these. And I went as a student there with my IC, that is called identity card, that is not a passport. And it's a yellow color thing. So everyone has this passport, and you go there at that point and you show it, and they just turn it around. And this, it takes a time, and then they will tell you to wait a little while and they will go check. That moment felt really like you just are scared and you don't feel like you belong there. But since even you're born here, you feel like an outsider. You feel like the government itself is like, you feel like, an outsider. So it feels like anger and maybe, it's a hard word to say, but an insult or somehow, you get this thing. So I think all Tibetans who travel go through these things, and that was my first thing. And since being in Paris for like, in Paris, and I studied fashion, but later I always felt like I don't fit in, And the question about like, I say, oh, I'm from Tibet, but not born in Tibet, but from India. And they say, are you Indian? Well, actually, I don't own an Indian passport. I'm actually a refugee there. They don't actually get the whole story. So you have to repeat it. But then since you have never seen your country, Tibet, and I feel like more an Indian, I'm like, I eat a lot more Indian food or love the Indian cinema. So, I always have this question and also love my identity as a Tibetan, there's a, so I think like, these all things kind of bothers you inside. It's always there. And I think that kind of drove me to also question my own people. And I think since you stay like within yourself, you don't question it. The day you just come out from your comfort zone or come out from your, like, I don't know, from Dharamsala, or you get lost. Because then you feel the necessity to, have an identity, all this. And then you get, this frustration or I don't know. So I think this happens with a lot of Tibetans, and this film is also for the Tibetans themselves to actually, you know, see and question themselves and about their, I don't know, like freedom of expression, a lot of things. And my film is also like based on like how I struggle myself, and I've seen a lot of now a lot of immigrants coming also because they think something is better there. We always think like something is better somewhere else, and we kind of keep migrating. And I understand also this is because of economical reasons, a lot of other reasons, and I totally get it. They want a better life like anyone else, you know. So I think this is like, and that in that process, so many things happen. Family kind of like separates, and they feel lonely. They can't find a friend, or the language is different. You know, when you come from France, you think like, okay, everything is going to be okay because I speak a little bit of English. But no, French people don't speak English. You know, I struggled with that. And you come there, and then you find so many different people, and suddenly you get lost, and the mentality is different, the food is different, everything is different. So I think then it arises, you know, like the question, all these things. And many people, Tibetan people, are actually, you know, struggling in France and in Paris, and now there are a lot more. They can find each other and, you know, comfort each other in a sense, but still they are like, it's hard. It's still hard, and voila. So I think I don't want to be so long, but that's a point, I think.
Okay, Marcel, I will maybe come back to some of the things you said later, but let's go to Pimpaka, whose film, you know, touches upon a very different aspect of being a kind of an outsider. Correct me if I'm wrong. Your film is about a Muslim brother and sister from Bangkok going to the south of Thailand to kind of sort of find themselves in a sense. And what was really interesting about your film is, and you know, many of us have been to Thailand, but we see Thailand pretty much as a homogenous Thai country. You know, we don't expect it to have, you know, Muslims. I mean, we know that in the south of Thailand there's like trouble with some Muslim insurgents and things like that, but somehow Thailand is Thai, right? And here we have a film where you have two older young Muslims who, if we didn't know that they were Muslim, we'd probably think they were Thai because they speak Thai, they feel, they look Thai, you know. So, I mean, I guess my question is, what made you want to cast or base a story that talked about the minority Muslims? And just what was the starting point? If you could tell us a bit more also about the status of Muslims in Thailand.
Okay, so I think most of people from outside look at the Thailand as you say, you know, because we look at from the surface and from the, you know, like the promotion from tourism of Thailand. But in Thailand, we have so many inside, you know. We, if you heard, you know, we still in the military government, and we also have in the political unstable, because a lot of people, you know, we have like people who divided, the nation divided into group of people, like, and which, you know, represent by the t-shirt of color, if you know from the news, you know. And for, you know, outsider, they may be thought that is, you don't understand it, but, you know, but for me, you know, being Thai, you know, I feel like you have to choose which side you take, otherwise you'll be in like minority. You have to say something which side you taking on. So that's why, you know, when we start to do this project, we actually, because my co-writer, he's Muslim. He's a Muslim living in Bangkok, and he's very famous critic, a film critic. And we talk a lot about, you know, being Muslim in Bangkok. So when the insurgency, actually the insurgency rapidly happened in 2001, and now it's still going on now. So it's a very violent conflict, you know, it's also, but it's not in Bangkok, but it's, you know, like it's happened in the southernmost part of Thailand where the majority are Muslim. So after we talk about that situation, so we decided to travel to the south. And my co-writer, he said to me, he said that if he go there, he would feel fit in the community because they are Muslim. Because he feel alienated when he living in Bangkok. Because he found himself as a minority. Even he can, you know, he can have a Buddhism friend, you know. So that's why it attached me a lot. But when we went there and we got back, I asked him, you still think that you fit in the in the South, he said, no, he's still alienated. So it's a kind of, you know, like the feeling that I got from my co-writer, and so we start to make that project. And for me, I think, me too, I feel alienated, you know, in every part of Thailand. Because, you know, sometimes when I feel to say something that, you know, that I thought is true, but I'm a minority, you know, I cannot say it in publicly. If I say it publicly, a majority feel that I'm not right, you know. This is always happening, you know, even now. You know, recently the king just passed away, you know. I know that you heard about that. And it's the majority of people need to do something like to express, like, you know, griefness. But if someone didn't express that, there will, a lot of people might thought he not feel respect to the king. This is the kind of situation, you know. You need to be part of the majority. Otherwise you will be in, you know, in the feeling that you might do something wrong. So the film, my film, is kind of, you know, like a self-discovery of a person who feels like alienated, you know, and she found that, you know, if she go there with the majority of people, she might fit to that, but, you know, at the end, it's not. So this is the theme of my film.
That's really interesting, because what you're saying is, even if you, you know, are part of the majority, you can still feel alienated because you don't actually share the you know, the feelings of the majority, right?
Yes. So it's like, you, how can you identify yourself as, you know, as a citizen in your country, you know, in, like, from the ID card, or, you know, from the gender, or, you know, yeah. I think it's a kind of a question that I'm asking for. Yeah.
So, Rokhsareh, your film is about another kind of refugee, an Afghan refugee who's living in Tehran. And I guess we know that in the Middle East there's, you know, a lot of fluidity of people going, you know, back and forth. But in your film, it becomes very apparent what it means to be, again, you know, a refugee, like an Afghani refugee in Iran. And your film kind of, that's kind of a big fight in your film as well, right? You know, the fact that she's a refugee. Mm-hmm. So can you just share with us a little bit about background of your film, why you were interested in that?
I think in my film I tried to not to, I mean, there is a lot I could say I didn't, because I became more focused on the problem of forced marriage, but there is a lot, there's a lot of problems, and there's a lot I can talk about. How is life of Afghan refugees in Iran? When I met Sonita, you know, 3 million Afghan refugees are living in Iran. Most of them are illegal, undocumented. Most of them, I mean, they have come to Iran from 40 years ago, from the beginning of Soviet war till today. They are still coming, but when they are, I mean, most of them are Hazara minority, unlike Sonita. Sonita is Thai, but which are an Asian group in Afghanistan who are very discriminated in Afghanistan, and there have been many genocides for Hazara minority. They have some Mongolian groups, and people hate them, and they are Shia, and they are very poor. So they come to Iran because Iran is also Shia. But they live a very hard life in Iran, and it is kind of a stigma. Being an Afghan, if somebody tells that, one day I came with Sonita to an office, to help them to see if I can get paper. And the guy sitting here and asked me, what do you want? And I said, she's an Afghan, I came here to see if I can get papers for her. And she asked me, are you also an Afghan? And I said, no, son. Oh, sorry, I didn't mean anything. And you even don't look like them, you really look good. I mean, I was thinking, God, she's listening. It was very normal. She even did that. And then she wrote a song, and I produced a song named Forgive Me for Being an Afghan. So it is like, it was a song that saw, forgive me for being an Afghan. So it's, there's a, like that, you know, people can tell to an Afghan that you, you know, although you are an Afghan, but you are clean, or something like that. So, you know, you're clean, how can you be an Afghan? So it's a horrible, because also there's no education in TV or school about racism or anything. all the education is about nationalism, because we are a nation who have been invaded a lot of times, and all that's in danger of, I mean, like being like UK, I mean United Kingdom, America, everybody wanted to control our country. So all the education is about being nationalist, being like protect your country from any foreigner. So people just don't have this on even TV. There was a TV comic show that an Afghan character was there, and he was funny because he had an Afghan accent, not because he was doing anything funny. He was talking an Afghan, Persian in Afghan accent, and it was, people could feel free to laugh.
Right.
So that's but then I met Sonita. It was the first time I was talking to an Afghan woman, although they have been in Iran for 40 years. You never see them, they're invisible, they are not in the sphere. So, you know, in the you can talk to an Afghan worker, but usually women, Iranian women, try not to. But not, you even can't see an Afghan woman because they are just they don't come out of homes.
Right.
And Stoyanka was the first Afghan woman I talked to, and she told me about this tradition of selling girls and everything, and I got interested. And I felt very sad because she couldn't go to school; she was denied from schools in Iran because she didn't have any ID. And she wanted, so for learning how to read and write, she, as a child, she tried hard to find somebody to teach her. Her mother even didn't care, so it was difficult. It was her dream to go to school. So I was feeling very guilty and very bad, as, you know, as an Iranian, I should do something. I should give them a voice. So there is a lot I didn't tell in my movie.
Okay. Junfeng made a film called Apprentice, which some may have seen. But one of the things that stood out for me when I watched this film, as an aside, because the film is really not about that, is that the two main characters in the film are Malay, Muslims Malay, in Singapore. And again, for me, to see a Singapore film that had two characters very much part of the kind of mainstream, government setup, but not being Chinese, which somehow in my mind, even though I've been to Singapore and I should know better, seemed kind of an anomaly, you know. And so I immediately kind of wondered whether that casting of two Malays in this film was in some way trying to, deal with this issue of a minority community in Singapore, but Junfeng told me that actually it had nothing to do with that. But nonetheless, I think it's important, or it will be interesting to hear from Junfeng about the idea of minorities making up a community like Singapore, and how do these minorities actually cope with each other in the sense of being Singaporean.
Well, to address the first part, like I was mentioning yesterday at the Q&A, that the reason why the two characters are Malay is because purely because of casting. I decided when I was casting for the film that I didn't want to dictate which race the characters were going to be. I just wanted to look for two actors that had the best chemistry between them. So in that sense, it was in a way quite progressive, because we didn't want to define it by color, essentially. And so it just so happened that the two actors in Singapore and Malaysia that we found happened to be Malay, and therefore we translated the script into Malay, which is a language I don't speak. But with that, obviously we cannot hide from the fact that they are both Malay, and therefore within the script, some of the cultural nuances the fact that that bond perhaps becomes just a little bit stronger because they are both, in a way, outsiders in a Chinese majority society. Ford brings the two men just a little bit closer, I think. But I didn't want to underscore that so much because already I'm dealing with the death penalty. I didn't want another sort of big issue to kind of overshadow the issue that I wanted to address. But I coming to talk about minorities in Singapore, I think the reality is we like to pretend that there isn't racism, but there is. And with social media, a lot of these incidents just surface a lot more frequently now than they used to. And people are starting to maybe wonder what exactly is this veneer of racial harmony about. Just a bit of a background, the idea of a Singapore identity is something that's very, very new. Singapore became independent in the 60s and we separated from Malaysia. And during that period, there was a lot of racial tensions. And therefore, after separation, for Singapore to sort of economically grow, they needed everyone to sort of come together and therefore present. They instilled, actually, to a whole generation of younger Singaporeans, the importance of racial harmony. And actually, a large part of it also has to do with the fact that we have conscription. And so we all have to serve in the military. And to do that, we need to know what we're defending. What is this identity that we are defending? And actually, I think I touched upon that a little bit more in my first film, Sandcastle, which is about a young man who is just before his enlistment, finds out that his father used to be a political detainee in Singapore and sort of a leftist detainee. There was a period of McCarthyism in Singapore in the 60s, essentially, and a lot of the left were accused of being communists, and therefore they were detained without trial. And so there was a period of trauma that my parents' generation had to deal with. And that also had to do with the fact that a lot of them ended up just becoming just very apolitical, and no one wanted to touch politics. People just relished in the fact that, okay, the economy is growing, our lives are getting better, so let's just perhaps turn a blind eye to some of these other issues that used to be important, but maybe now we have found our comfort zones and we can move on from there. And so then there are people who are left behind or left out. And as a Chinese Singaporean, I often have a certain sense of a privileged guilt, if you will, in trying to sort of understand what the racial politics is in Singapore, which to me was never a part of my education. We always just imagine that everything is fine, everyone has the same rights, but in truth, I mean, some are just more equal than others.
Okay. And then turning to our last panelist here, Kiwi. He's made a film which hasn't shown yet, so you won't have seen that film, but it's showing this afternoon at 2:30, I think, right? It's a film called 10 Years, and it's an omnibus film made by five young Hong Kong directors. The premise is very simple. It's what is Hong Kong going to look like in 10 years' time? And Kiwi's film is called Self-Immolation, and it focuses on an independence kind of activist group operating, fighting for Hong Kong independence in 10 years' time. And one of the things that immediately stands out in this film, his segment of this 10 years, is the fact that one of these activists is actually Pakistani, a young Pakistani girl who's also, very much engaged in this freedom struggle for Hong Kong. And of course, we look at Hong Kong and we see it as a Chinese city, and suddenly here you have a Chinese filmmaker making a film about a city where you have an activist who's not Chinese, who's actually, South Asian. So that immediately, kind of drew my interest and made me wonder what is it about, because clearly I think Kiwi's idea is that, you know, Hong Kong is not just a Chinese place, there are many other people who have a stake in its future. And so if you could just tell us a little bit about why you decided to, you know, include a South Asian activist in the Hong Kong freedom struggle 10 years from now.
因為我用的巴基斯坦人是一個本身都是香港的，所以一個問題就是中國政府經常都在罵香港人，你為什麼反中國啊？你不是中國人嗎？So
he actually wanted to make one thing clear, the Pakistani girl that he uses in the film is actually from Hong Kong itself. And something that has to be understood is that, like, something that the Chinese government keeps saying is that, like, or keeps giving Hong Kong a hard time about is, like, why are you guys so anti-China? Aren't you guys also Chinese?
So this idea is also to encourage the audience to think, what we're watching is not our race, it's our value.
Okay. So he actually wanted to stimulate audiences to think about, like, questions not of race, but of actually of values.
個價值就係我哋香港係咪可以獨立咧？咁呢個問題，我覺得唔關個膚色事嘅。So
the values that he wants to talk about is whether Hong Kong should be independent, which is a question that has nothing to do with race.
而呢一個問題就係喺香港其實講獨立咧，其實係一個好敏感嘅一個問題。And
Hong Kong, whether Hong Kong should be independent, is actually a very, very sensitive topic.
我講個例子俾你聽啊，就係話我有一個演員當 casting 嘅時候咧，揾佢做，佢好想同我合作，咁但係一見到劇本關於港獨，佢就唔做。
I'll just give you an example. Like during the casting period, there was actually an actor who really, really wanted to work with him. But when the actor actually saw the script and saw that it was about Hong Kong independence, like he immediately backed out.
我套戲唔係話一定係支持定係反對，但係我想。
His film does not mean to support or oppose Hong Kong independence. It's just to stimulate a discussion around the topic.
但係個問題就係，佢嘅答案就係，我如果接拍咗，我永遠翻唔到大陸拍戲，我失去咗個工作嘅機會。But
the actor's point was that, like, if I'm part of this film, I would never be able to act on the mainland in China.
我問佢，佢係咪支持港獨啊？佢話唔係，我好憎共產黨添，但係我唔敢做。佢唔敢做。但係佢唔係支持港獨。誒，佢好嬲共產黨嘅。
Okay. So like when he asked the actor whether he supports Hong Kong independence, the actor actually said, "I actually really hate the Communist Party, but I don't have the guts to do it."
所以呢個我覺得就係即係香港嘅呢個問題，我係有啲議題。 係喺電影裏面出現，唔能夠出現嘅。So
this is a very this is a problem in Hong Kong. There's a lot of topics that cannot appear in cinema.
甚至講多個例子，有一個記者問我：你點樣迴避港獨呢個罪名？迴避港獨嘅罪名。Like
even there was actually a journalist who asked him, how are you going to dodge from the sin or like the charge of Hong Kong independence?
咁即係話港獨就係罪名咯。
So does that mean that like supporting Hong Kong independence is a crime?
咁但係香港其實係有言論自由，係可以討論嘅。But
Hong Kong actually does have freedom of speech. Like anyone can actually discuss this topic.
但係香港最大問題就係自我審查，係自己都唔講。But
the biggest problem in Hong Kong is self-policing. Like people would regulate their own speech to steer away from such topics.
因為好驚共產黨。Because
people are very scared of the Communist Party.
有人講，呢套戲其實係香港電影歷史裏面第一次提及港獨。People
say that this is actually the very first movie in Hong Kong history that mentions Hong Kong independence.
咁呢個亦都係希望我想用一啲咁敏感嘅議題去同香港觀眾或者想去討論嘅就係思想自由。So
one thing that he actually also wants to bring out in this film is freedom of thought.
即係原來我有好多自由，其實係自我限制嘅。 包括個演員，佢自己唔夠膽；包括個記者，已經以為港獨係罪名。Because
a lot of questions of thought actually have to do with self-control and self-regulation and how you regulate your own thoughts. For example, the actor not being willing to be cast in the movie, and the journalists automatically assuming that Hong Kong independence is a crime.
所以翻翻轉頭，點解揀一個巴基斯坦籍嘅一個女士，都係希望即係刺激觀眾嘅思考。So
basically, going back to the question of why he decided to cast a Pakistani girl is just to stimulate the audience's thinking.
呢個係整套十年，唔單止我，五套電影，五個導演想希望嘅就係引發多啲嘅討論，討論香港嘅將來。So
not just his segment of the film, but all five directors with all their different segments of the film, their central vision is to be able to stimulate more discussion about Hong Kong's future.
Thank you. So we've had a fascinating range of kind of backgrounds, experiences, coming at converging upon this question of identity, of nationality, of exclusion, you know, inclusion. So I guess one of the things that you know, I find interesting in this discussion is you know, how do you stake a claim to be you know, part of a nation if you are a minority group? You know, I think all of us are kind of talking about that, right? So is it actually possible? And I think maybe like Singapore seems to be a country where you are trying to, you know, or you have a system in place that is at least superficially, you know, a place where you have two minorities and a majority group, but all kind of united in this idea of being a Singaporean. And is that something that actually works? Is that something that can work?
Well, one of the bigger issues that surfaced recently, as with most of the world, is immigration. And so, yes, it has always been two minorities, well, actually more than two minorities. There are two major minorities and a lot of smaller minorities, and then a Chinese majority. But now it's become a case of the us versus them is a lot more obvious where immigration is concerned, because we have a lot of, especially new Chinese immigrants, new Indian immigrants, and new Filipino immigrants, and elsewhere in Southeast Asia. And that divide becomes a lot more obvious. And that also has a lot to do with, as I said earlier, this doctrine that has come into place over the past several decades that celebrates this idea of what being Singaporean is. And that actually is quite an artificial idea built primarily, in my opinion, on the need for conscription. And then now it becomes like, why are they here with all these rights and enjoying all these amenities, and they haven't been in the army, or they haven't, you know, lived here long enough to serve? So that divide has become quite different now, and I think people are starting to grapple with this idea of what immigration is and what it means to them, because essentially Singapore is an immigrant society.
Pimpaka, if I can ask you about the same question, you know, in a country where you have a large Muslim minority, do they feel tied? Is there something that binds, you know, people where they can sort of all proudly like be part of the same country?
I mean, for the Muslim people who are living in the southern one part of Thailand, they're quite, because I've been there many times, and you know, I did also the workshop with the young people in the south. I think they found themselves quite connected to Malaysia, because they have their own language that quite similar to Malay. And they have their own quiet. They are like cross community, you know. They don't feel like to travel to the city like in Bangkok. Because I often ask, you know, like young people, what you feel, and they said that, you know, after they graduated in that university, they might further their study in Malaysia than in city like in Bangkok. But the other problem in Thailand that we quite face a lot of is that ethnic minority from Burma. We have a really huge immigrant worker from Burma, which, you know, even you know, nowadays, I mean, they have quite, because, I mean, majority of Thai people quite not like, you know, immigrant workers from Burma, because they mostly found they kind of, you know, like, they found that, because, you know, in Thailand it's quite strange, you know, if you live in Bangkok, you feel like you're first class citizen. But if you live like in the northern part of Thailand, or northeastern part of Thailand, southern part of Thailand, you feel like a second class of citizen. But for the third class citizen, it's like the immigrant workers. So it's kind of situation where people divided like in classes in a way, you know, without saying, but we feel that way. And I think that's really the main issue now is like, you know, the majority would like to the immigrant worker to go back to their own country. But, you know, they still, you know, living there. And I think the number of the unofficial number is like 2 million people now in Thailand. Yeah, and it's still in the issue now. But I mean, when it happened, like, there are some people got killed by immigrant worker, they might say, like, you know, this is a bad, you know, bad hit, you know, we have to, you know, it's on the news every time. Or even when the insurgency happened in the South, they would say, like, this is a South bad hit. You know, it's like kind of, you know, like the word that, you know, represent like this is all people. It's like this kind of a citizen, you know. It's represent like a, you know, a group of minority, you know. It's a kind of situation, yeah.
So in other words, it's very difficult to accept all these people into the
larger society. But I mean, in the surface, we could see Thai people, you know, like welcome foreigner. A lot of smile, yes, a lot of smile. But you know, deep down, you know, it's really hard to say, you know. But we could see from the media, and we even could see from the social media now, because you know, in the social media, they have so many, you know, like you know, really. I mean, they have a big argument, you know, against this kind of the group of people. You know, for foreigner, you couldn't find it, you know, in public, but for Thai. Yeah, we see. Yeah.
And what about Iran? In terms of an Iranian identity, you know, belonging to a nation called Iran, how does that go?
Iran, in the beginning of 20th century, we had Reza Shah, the father of Shah. He built an identity, but before that we were like, we were like a land with a lot of tribes, different languages, and still we are like that. But then Reza Shah built an illusion of a nation for us that we are all Aryan, which is not very scientific, like who is Aryan. And then, so he was a good friend of Hitler, and that's why we got occupied at the end by allies, I mean like by UK and France and Russia, because he had a good connection with Hitler and he was feeling here Americans and Germans were also Aryans. And Iranians have this kind of national, fake national pride that they think they are better than Arabs and Turks and everybody. And then Afghanistan have been mostly like till 200 years ago, we have been almost the same country. So there is no, you cannot see Sonita and think she's not Iranian, because there is nothing like, no, just, and also Herat got separated from Iran 100 years ago. Just this is the border, but they are speaking the same language, they are, everything is the same, just as a border. But then, because this Iranian nationalism says that, and also because it's a mountainous country, so the development happens there much slower, they don't have oil, they have been in war for so many years, so they don't have, so everything makes them poor and uneducated and coming to Iran as economic refugees. So Iranians really look down at them, although there is nothing like, we have most of the history of being the same nation. In our literature, their cities are like mentioned as the cities of Iran or the same country that named Iran but the same kingdom under a king. But then now, yeah, Iran is really like Iranian identity is inside our borders. We think like that, and they don't like people look down at Afghans, especially at Afghans. They don't have a good life in Iran, and they come go to Europe, and they don't say that we have been living in Iran. They say that direct, but some of them have been born in Iran. You will never get an Iranian passport if you don't have an Iranian father, even if you have been born in Iran for generations, never you get it. So I know many children who never been in Afghanistan. They went to Germany and they got deported to Afghanistan, and they don't know anybody, that they can't speak even that accent.
Right.
And they find themselves in a very new country, and they're really sad. So,
so they feel like they belong to Iran in some way.
They belong to a country that they look down at them, but they don't. Sonita was had the same problem. Sonita cannot speak a proper. She speaks dialects of Herat, which is like, but she can't speak the dialect. They all speak Persian, but it's different accents. She can't speak Kabuli accent, which is what you learn in schools. In Afghanistan, because he has never been in school in Afghanistan. So when her raps are in Herati accent, it is like you rap in a, and it's a bit funny because it's like a country, like a, you know, it's not the major, the main language of Afghanistan.
Right, right.
And she can't sing in she always has an Iranian accent even when she sings in Herati. So. For Afghanis, she is not a proper Afghani, and for Iranians, she is only a dirty Afghan.
Right.
So that's how they, unfortunately, they talk about Afghan people. So yeah, she can't fit in any kind. When we were in Afghanistan, she couldn't fit at all. She was missing Iran. So she has this, yeah, this identity problem, and most Afghans have these problems that. They don't know where they belong to, because they're born in Iran, but they don't belong. I think most immigrants in the world.
I think so, yeah. I mean, this is certainly an experience that I think Dasel and me share, being Tibetans who've grown up in India, or who were born in India and grew up here. But at the same time, as you can see from the Tibetan Children's Village where we are, we have been able to kind of maintain some kind of a bubble, like, you know, a parallel reality, where we live separate from the Indian majority. But within this little bubble, we feel kind of like, you know, we have our own little community. But as soon as we leave this bubble, we realize that even if we go to the big cities in India, Tibetans are, you know, kind of discriminated against, as are people from the northeast of India, because, you know, we look different. And of course, when you go to the west, then you really realize that you're saying you're Tibetan, but you've never been to Tibet, you've never seen Tibet,
yeah, yeah.
And you know, and if you were deported back to Tibet, you'd be like lost, right? So it's this kind of strange in-between world that we inhabit. And I guess India, it's much easier for us because the Indian government has actually allowed us to maintain our own identity. But when we leave this comfort zone, like Nasir was saying, and I want to ask you, because, you know, from all of us, you are the person who's actually experienced this whole, situation of being a migrant in Europe, for instance, which is something that's such a big issue right now. So, how do you feel having lived in France for what, 16 years now?
Yes.
And I mean, do you think at some point you could become French, or how do you think it works in that sense?
Since I migrated as a student, I never actually had difficulty as an immigrant and going through all the paperwork. I think if I went through all this, I would have a lot more like a tough thing going on. I think France is very, very tough. Like the films like A Syrian Love Story, where at the end you see like how they live, it's actually the truth, but you don't actually see how they line up, you know, the long queues to for the paperwork, and then you see so many people from different countries, not just Tibetans, but Africans, South Africans, and many others, and then you get in the line and you realize that, you know, so many strong feelings come up. But somehow, because of the image of the Dalai Lama, it helps in a way. It gives this image of kindness and very good that kind of Tibetan people profit out of, right? So you know, that they do something bad and they get caught, they're like, oh, Dalai Lama people, you know? So they get, you know, they get like kind of lucid and, you know, like it's a very strong image that, but at the same time, when you want to be like, say something or be free or, you know, be yourself and, you know, express yourself, then you can't as well, because then you have this image as well. And they're like, you know, you're supposed to be a Dalai Lama person, so that also kind of comes. But what we were discussing right now, I have this interesting thing. There were like many Tibetan immigrants now. So I worked as a translator somehow, like I wanted to actually observe, and I love talking to, you know, different people and just listen to them. And they were like, they got their papers, like refugee papers, and then they have this two days course to, they explain the like French government and the history and how, you know, like we integrate with each other, all these different people, and how the French government gave the right to, you know, each one of us had the right to have our own religion, but in the house and not outside, and all these things. And it's very, very nice. I actually learned a lot from there.
Right.
And then I have to translate it to the Tibetans. So there would be like sometimes a lot of Tibetans, like 15, 16 is a lot. Then sometimes it would be like 4 or 5. Then there was this young guy, Tibetan man, sitting near, and I just told him to come closer to me, and you know, so that I can explain, because he looks like he doesn't care much, because he's got the paper now. But then I just said, like, it's very important, you have to understand, and I just draw him in towards me, and I said, sit down here, I really need to explain them, like, you know, I really wanted them to understand it. So there was this thing, like, he looked around and he observed a lot of Muslims, African Muslims, Afghanistan, Russian as well, and Pakistani, and a lot of them, and a lot of black people, but they are Muslims, most of them, and Tunisian, Moroccan, a lot of them. And then he looked around and he said, like, my God, there are so many, you know, different people here. And I said, yeah, that's normal. I mean, like, France is like this. Well, I expected only French people. And I said, well, no, France is like a mix of many culture and of everything. And it's also because, you know, because of that, you're here too. And then he said, like, you know, if Tibet is free, I don't think I will allow these things. So I got like a little scared. Like, you know, and I said, why are you here? I said, like, you're here because you are different, and you are from a country that suffers, and you're here because, you know, not because you're French. You are an outsider as well. I mean, you have to accept the differences. I said, well, you know, it will be very tough. I won't. It's like, well, you know, you really have to have your time, look around, talk to different people, not just the Tibetans. You know, meet different people. It's very important, I was telling him. Because this kind of thought process is kind of dangerous, I think, right? Because since we're Tibetans, we never saw our country. He's also someone who grew up in India. If he has such thoughts, right? He, of course, maybe he didn't kind of had this conflict, you know, had this direct problem becoming, like, I don't know, from Tibet or anything. But even he has this thought process, and I was wondering how many other have these. And we do have this, you know, like, we do judge, we do have our own race thought sometimes, you know, because of our difference and everything. But I thought that, you know, it's very dangerous in a way that, you know, we are not educated in that sense. You know, like a total, our own importance, our own religion, our own people and all that. And within ourselves, there are so many other differences as well. Like, oh, I'm from this side of the Tibet or that side. And then we would make our own group. And yeah, we would have just hang out all, you know. So it's, it kind of bothers me in a way, you know, like people ask me, the first question when I meet a Tibetan, sometimes they will just ask me, like, from which country of Tibet? Your mother, what is, which part of Tibet? And I do know, but I kind of, I don't give so much importance on that. And I answer back, I'm just a Tibetan, And I don't want to say that I'm from this side or that side, I just want to get along with everybody. But to be very honest, I do have my own judgments towards certain things. I also don't want to be in a group, a particular group, and say that I belong there. And you know, this I think kind of grows and then it becomes something else that I don't like. So that was interesting on that part when I was listening to all of you. And you know, it's also important to share such things. And sometimes I was also thinking, like, you know, when I was listening, I was like, do I have to share this? Because, you know, I don't want to put the Tibetan people into a bad light. It's not my aim. But it's also like human to, we are all humans and we have to be honest and, you know, like to discuss and to, you know, grow from here, right?
I want to add something. When in Afghanistan, especially when we went there, and we knew this before, in Afghanistan there are three major communities like Tajik, Pashtun, Hazara, and also Uzbeks who are speaking Turkish, kind of Turkish, and they hate each other in a way that they have been killing each other just because you are Tajik, I'm going to kill you. Or just because you are Pashtun, and just like all the civil war were like this, they were separated the city to different ethnicities, and with rockets they were shooting at each other. And then you are in Afghanistan, the first question is, where in Afghanistan you are from, and which ethnicity you belong. And then they, for example, some people were, when I was there, I tried to communicate with everybody and find a lot of friends, but then some people were talking to me like, why you are hanging out with so many Hazaras? Don't add them on your Facebook. On my Facebook, I received things like, somebody said, oh, you recently added so many Hazara people. Like, so sometimes I tell to some Afghans who are in Iran and they criticize Iranians for racism. I just tell them, yeah, you're right, but just look at yourself. They are very discriminated, and that's what Hazaras are coming to Iran because there have been 2-3 main genocides against them just try to clean the country from Hazara. So this kind of problems also exist in Afghanistan and Iran. In Iran, because of Reza Shah, we had this illusion of being a nation, so we don't discriminate each other at all. But we make jokes about each other, people from different cities, but we really don't discriminate. But then we strongly discriminate people from out of our borders.
I'm just going to our audience here. Has it stimulated any questions? Do you want to, you know, talk about anything? Yeah, please.
I'm from Kerala, and from listening to this, how Iran had a strong national identity from a long time ago. We have had a recent history of us being together as an entire country when we started fighting the British and all that. So, from what you guys know, do you think the reason for people to migrate leads them to be exploited in a different degree? Like I'm from Kerala, in the southern part of India, and we've been constantly traveling all over the world for economic reasons to get jobs, and we're used to that a lot. But now what happens, we have a lot of people coming in from Tamil Nadu, Bangladesh, and Bihar, and they're discriminated by Malayalis. But people from Kerala discriminate them for coming to our state for jobs. Whereas we've been traveling all over the world to get jobs.
Right. And discriminated.
So is it that tip for that? Like, I've got it from there, I'm going to give it to you here. Sometimes some people are migrating for worse reasons, for saving their lives.
Yes.
Do they get more exploited than people who are traveling for jobs or traveling for education? I mean, from you people have explored this a lot, so I would like to know why. I mean, is there different reasons to exploit different people?
Yeah, that's a very, very interesting question. And I think one thing is clear from you know, what we just heard is that there is obviously an ingrained sense of racial superiority that binds people who belong to the same kind of community or group, very tightly together, that becomes kind of more vulnerable when you are outside that comfort zone, right? So yeah, so you know, when like Malayalis travel outside Kerala, then you know, they get discriminated against. But in your own place, you are the majority, so maybe it's just different. Yeah, it's like what she's saying. You know, even a Tibetan who's actually a refugee in France is thinking about, when we become free, we are not going to let people come into
that far.
That kind of strange thinking. Yeah, that's
is it the some people blame it on the insecurity of losing their jobs to migrants, but I don't completely buy that. Or is it like a pack mentality? They have too much pride in themselves that they hate someone else, or is it plain ignorance? So I don't understand the reason, because it's different for each people, but commonly we hate.
I think it's all together.
Yeah.
And I think the economic, like the last one, the job thing, that comes later on. Like when they see that lots of them are, you know, taking their, then they realize it. But this doesn't come first. I think the other two comes like kind of, the pride is very, very, I think the first point, like you feel more superior because your parents or your people told you like you're important, and the importance kind of grow inside you as if you think like you're the, you know. But then you, like me too, for me too, as a Tibetan I feel very proud when I'm, you know, like you're here and you struggle and everything, and then you go outside, you're nobody. You're nobody. Even the language that they say, like the Tibetan language is so important, which I think it's very important, and I have to learn it, I have to improve it, I know, and I will, because this is my identity. But if you come out of your comfort zone, and if you go to a country, please, you wouldn't get a job with this language. You have to be honest, right? Like a Tibetan language, I mean, you know. So it is important to ourselves. And then there was also this debate about like making the Tibetan government all only in Tibetan language. Yeah. Then my question is like, how will you, I mean, communicate with the rest of the world? You shouldn't go back, we should just go forward. And then there are like other Tibetans who grew up in different countries, they feel so guilty of not knowing their own language, but they are so rich. You know, like in Swiss or France, there are people who can just, like, their education level is high, and they can speak the language like the French people or anybody. And they are, like, staying away because they don't feel like, oh, I don't speak the Tibetan, and I'm not good enough, and I'm afraid to being criticized, and I can't participate, which is, like, such a loss, you know? And those people who speak the Tibetan language fluently and write fluently, they think that they can do so much. But then they go, and the communication level is poor, you can't. I'm sorry, you know, so it's important that we have from different sides and, you know, be strong with our own, you know, like, and not just, you know, give the importance in just one point, just, you know, let them know that everything is important and all other cultures is important, and respect, you know, others as well as much as ourselves. So for me, that was the issue that was going on, and I have a lot of debate with Tibet, and I fight with them all the time, you know. But I'm happy that I'm out from this school, because I'll get punished.
maybe Diana.
So I think relating with the title of the topic, and also something that came up yesterday after the Sunita film, I assume that a lot of the issues you want to discuss, like, it might be invisible in the context in which it was shot. So, for example, you were talking about how no one in Afghanistan is interested in or it's very difficult. It would be very difficult to show your film in Afghanistan, for example. I'm sure your film in Hong Kong would probably be quite difficult to show there. Tenzing and I had a situation where a certain work was difficult to show in Bangladesh. Like, so how do you guys kind of deal with showing your work in a context that might not want to see it? So I'm a bit sick, so I might be
I never received any interest almost from any Afghan person. I mean, all kind of nationalities in the world showed interest in this movie and not Afghan. So it seems that they are not even interested in this. But I mean, I can just try to take this movie and show it to people, like impose it to people. But there is no curiosity, there is no request from that side. At least Iranian people there are some people who are very curious to see the movie. At least because it has been an Iranian movie, has been in many festivals, so they're curious. But Afghans are even not curious. Just they have so many problems. I think their life is so difficult. They are challenging. Still, it's harder. It's like every week there is a suicide bombing. They are struggling so hard that these things, they're not even curious. Because I understand that they are living in a survival-based
level. Mm-hmm. 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 Pimpaka, what about your film? Do you have that kind of a situation because of the subject you're tackling?
No, actually, I can release a film in Thailand, but it has more distribution. But the thing is, it's really funny. Actually, my film was banned in China. It's a really quite a strange situation because actually the film already shown in Shanghai International Film Festival. It's one more than, for cinematography, but it's shown without any problem. And then, there's a festival, in Fuzhou, invited my film being shown there. And actually, they invited me, ask me to be there with the actress. And then they just canceled my film just at last minute, 2 days before the festival start. And they emailed me, they have to cancel it because the censorship of the film sensitive. I really don't know what actually happened. So we asked them what is the issue, why it's so sensitive, because the film already shown in Shanghai without any problem. And they wrote to me and said that because the film dealing with the Muslim, ceremony, and they found it sensitive in that area. So that's why the censorship has to ban the film. This happened, not in Thailand, but that might be somewhere because of the sensitive, sensitivity of the issue that they found, not right. This has happened.
And I know, Junfeng, you had to be careful about how you made your film as well, or how you presented your film, in terms of the topics you were dealing with.
Well, capital punishment aside, and that more directly relating to the question, I think when news came out that I was making a Malay language film, the immediate reaction from, and I got this from some of the Chinese press in Singapore, it's like, why did you make a Malay film? Why would you make a Malay film? It's like, first of all, the market is obviously a lot smaller in Singapore, and because we do live in these language silos sometimes, especially in our media landscape. Our TV stations are defined by the Malay channel, the Chinese channel, the English channel, etc. So the Chinese press naturally would ask me why, and I would just ask why not. It's to me, and I realized also when we were marketing the film, the film ran in the commercial cinemas for 8 weeks in Singapore, and when we were marketing it, we knew that the Malay community would be sort of a natural audience for the film. And we wanted to push it more towards me being Chinese, and therefore there is a bigger market, and hopefully that will kind of bridge a reason for people to come to a Malay language film. And I think that worked to some degree. And I do think that it does take someone or a group of people who are willing to just break that, break some of these barriers, and then build these bridges.
Kiwi, maybe you can tell us a bit about, your case is obviously much more extreme in terms of the fact that you're dealing directly with the Communist Party of China. If you could,
Okay. 香港的情況比較特別，其實香港係冇法例去禁止我哋喺。
Hong actually has a more special situation. There's actually no kind of law that would prohibit him from screening his movie.
個問題係調翻轉係香港人自己去放棄個權利。舉個例子就係我哋十年咧，有好多嘅電影，有6間戲院放映。 中國政府有些權力者，有些嘅説話之後咧，啲戲院間間都冇播啦。
So the question is actually the reverse, like Hong Kong people actually like themselves give up on watching the film. So for example, the movie at first was actually screened in 6 different cinemas in Hong Kong, and every single showing was packed, it was all sold out. But once the Chinese government actually said something about it, all the cinemas stopped showing it.
所以香港個可悲地方就係佢自我審查嚴重，本身冇法例去禁止嘅。咁但係啲戲院因為大陸嘅壓力而放棄呢個權利。So
the situation in Hong Kong is the sad thing about Hong Kong is really just self-policing. There really is no reason why this film shouldn't be shown, but like under pressure from the Chinese government, all these cinemas stopped screening it.
用翻頭先個討論，我覺得就係我哋香港人個可悲之處就係我哋將自己嘅身份認同咧放棄，去自己歧視自己啲。Like
going back to the discussion that was going on earlier, the sad thing about Hong Kong is that Hong Kong people are giving up on their own identity and the right to claim their own identity.
但係都有一個可喜嘅地方就係話，當戲院我係長長full house嘅時候唔做啦，咁但係我哋有好多觀眾想睇到。
But the good thing actually, or like the silver lining to this entire story is that like when all these cinemas stopped screening the movie, there were still a lot of people who wanted to watch the film.
所以我哋嘅發行咧，我哋唔用商業戲院嗰個路就走。
So our distribution actually went away from commercial cinemas.
我哋走獨立電影，因為本身十年都係一個獨立電影，我哋去咗好多嘅社區放映。
So we actually went to some independent cinemas, and I mean, 10 years is actually an independent film, and they actually also went to a lot of community centers to screen it.
我哋喺戲院做咗差唔多3個月，但係戲院以外嘅放映咧，我係做咗半年。
They showed the film in cinemas for 3 months, but outside of actual cinemas, they screened it at different locations for half a year.
我哋去咗好多嘅學校啦、大專學校啦、教會啦，仲有好多嘅社區中心去放映。
They went to schools, community colleges, religious centers, and also a lot of community centers to show the film.
我哋甚至去啲單車鋪啊，都試過去放。They
even tried screening it at a bike shop.
因為我要爭取空間去俾香港人去睇呢部戲。Because
they wanted to find as much space as possible for Hong Kong people to be able to access to film.
啊，呢個都係即係我哋去面對即係中國政府嘅呢種恐懼嘅打壓，去要去做嘅嘢。These
are things that we have to do in order to face up to the pressure from the Communist Party.
因為好多確實有好多香港人係自己放棄自己所擁有嘅價值，身份認同，因為恐懼，因為利益。Because
there honestly are a lot of Hong Kong people who are giving up on their own values and their own identity out of fear and out of profit.
講咗最後一個例子就係，當我哋呢套戲喺香港金像獎攞咗最佳電影嘅時候咧，我哋得到嘅其實係一個懲罰。
One other example is that when this film actually won the Best Film Award at the Hong Kong Film Awards, it was actually seen as more of a punishment.
The punishment is,攞獎之前咧，好香港全部嘅電視台咧都報咗價，想買我哋10年嘅電影電視放映權，但係攞咗之後咧，全部都唔買。
So like the punishment is that before they got the awards, all of the television channels were actually bidding to buy the distribution rights for the film. But after they won the award, no one would bid anymore to buy it.
所以呢套戲其實喺香港有好大嘅爭議，好大嘅迴響。So
this film in Hong Kong is actually very, very controversial, but it's also like it also managed to get a lot of people to relate to it.
我用我一句作為一個總結，就係即係10年將好多香港嘅恐懼曝光，包括我頭先講嘅演員啦、戲院啦、電視台。So
basically, in a nutshell, Hong Kong, the film 10 years, like through the blanket off of a lot of symptoms in Hong Kong society, including what you mentioned earlier, like the actors, the cinemas, the television stations.
但係亦都同時間俾好多香港人去表達無懼啦，好多香港人。 好想睇好戲，爭取辦法。我頭先講嘅社區方面。
But it also showed us like how a lot of Hong Kong people are still fearless, in order to fight for the right to actually be able to watch this movie wherever they can.
Natasha, your question?
Oh, actually, my question was more like a comment on what he was saying. Actually, when he's talking about how people from Kerala have always been migrating and now the reverse is happening, it's also a very deep issue about identity and power play. And it's what happens is I actually belong to a community that I'm actually Zoroastrian or Parsi, as it's popularly known, and our forefathers migrated from what is today modern day Iran. Mm-hmm. So over here in India, the community status is very superior, because when the British invaded India, the community worked very closely with the British, and you know, the biggest businessmen, and we're seen as a very wealthy community and a very well-off community, quite apolitical, because we're kind of very comfortable in our own cocoon. But I know that in Iran, the few Zoroastrians that are left, they live in fear, or almost it's not, they can't express their religion quite publicly. And my own father, when he was traveling to Iran, he couldn't publicly tell anybody that he was Parsi. He was sitting in a group, and he happened to mention once that he was Parsi, and you know, there were awkward silences, and it's also a question of identity and power. So you know, when a group of people so are always deprived of their rights, when they suddenly have power, they automatically want to become dominating, like you said, the Tibetan man who thought that he will not allow any foreigners in Tibet. So I'm wondering how do you manage to portray the exact, I mean, how do you decide what you want to show in the film? Because also I see film as a medium for education. Everything that I know about the world, or to places about that I've never traveled, is through cinema, through film. So how do you maintain that delicate balance of portraying the exact right thing, or not being too sympathetic towards the group, or not being too anti a government? So it's just a question open to everybody on the panel.
Because it's a lot of censorship, I decided not to be focused on discrimination against Afghans. I had the footage, and in the beginning that was the theme of my movie, but when I moved to child forced marriage, I decided, okay, I have enough problems with this movie, let me not talk that much about or use the footage I have about them being so discriminated, because I just didn't want more. First of all, it didn't really match the theme of the movie anymore, because I was, but at the same time, I was a bit like, I mean, I have enough problems now with this movie, and I just don't want to really more. But then I didn't use many footage, like how they are denied from the schools, how they can't do anything, they are not a part of society. But then there are still some signs in the movie, but then I just decided not to be focused on that problem.
In Thailand, we also have the situation, you know, we have to face with like the censorship that's really quite strict. And we know that we have like, we call it taboo, like three taboo. One is we cannot make the film against, you know, the royal family. It's really the important one, you know, because we have a less majesty, you know, you could be in jail if you, you know, say something in publicly, you know, against the royal family. And the second is like, you know, religion, like Buddhism, because Thailand is a prominently Buddhism. And even, you know, like my film, I live in with the Muslim. I also have to face the situation where the right-wing Muslim people might, you know, think it's a bit sensitive in a way, because I portray like a young Muslim who, you know, quite, you know, wear not proper dress, you know, something like that. But and the other issue is, you know, politics, especially, you know, military, because now we're living in a military government. So I think most of the filmmakers, they self-censor a bit, you know, when they start making films. Like me, I have been in a self-censorship for a while, and then for this one, you know, I do like a metaphor instead of show, you know. Yeah. So that's why it's a kind of the situation that filmmakers dealing with. We did a lot of metaphor to us, you know, to express what we think about this kind of taboo. Because for example, like my film, I actually would like to show military side, because, you know, because in reality, we know that the policy of a government is like they just, you know, they just send the like 100,000 soldiers to stay there to serve the problem in the southern part of Thailand, which actually really, you know, not popular decision, you know, because most of the soldiers there, they are from other part of Thailand. They didn't know, actually, don't know the language there. They don't know how to do that, and they just, you know, be there because they got paid well, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, the government put a lot of money. You know, they got like really huge money to do a campaign in the south. It's a kind of situation. And, you know, if I show that kind of thing, you know, in film, my film might be in trouble. So we do a kind of metaphor, like we put the, you know, a guy who represents that soldier, and his car was wandering in the present day. We don't know how to escape, you know, something like that. We have to balance, you know, to do a lot of metaphor. That's, I think, most of the filmmakers announcement we've done that. Recently, there's one film that's also depicting the south of Thailand, and actually, it's the film that's funded by the Ministry of Interior, and they shot the film in the military camp in the south. And then when it's screened for official people and Muslim, the rightly Muslim people, they found the film sensitive too, so they banned the film. You know, it could be happened. Even the film already got support from the government. You know, we never know what happened, you know, because in Thailand we have like, you know, it's not a clear standard. Even you depict the film that, you know, portray like a taboo, but you know, you never know what's gonna happen. Yeah, because they have people who from government sector who in charge of, you know, allow you to show the film in Thailand.
I think on the issue of power, there was a period in Singapore where, you know, there were people who were migrating, especially to Australia, North America, Europe, and then there was a prime minister who sort of called it either you're a stayer or you're a quitter, and so it was quite a big topic at that time. And I remember during that period, I was still a teenager. I would hear like, well, in my parents' generation, like my uncles and aunts, they would be saying things like, why would I want to move to a place where I'll become a second-class citizen, right? And then it occurs to me that, you know, so if you choose to stay and you remain a first-class citizen, does that mean that you are creating a comfort zone at the expense of others? And I think that is very similar to I think most of our experiences.
Yeah.
But I think it really is about, like I said earlier, I mean, I do have a certain privilege guilt, and I know my privilege, and sometimes when if I belong to a certain class or a certain majority, it gives me a certain an easier way to address the issue, and it doesn't pigeonhole me the way a minority, if the minority, a minority person was to address the same issue. So I do find myself in a certain position sometimes to be able to maybe change some mindset or perception. So I mean, I do face resistance.
I would like to just clarify one small thing also. He was mentioning how in Hong Kong people are choosing to self-censor and sort of subvert their cultural whatever identity they have. They're choosing to let go of that. Now, in a society, if you take two extremes, they have completely cleansed ethnic, everything removed, and everybody is homogeneous. And between that and having a different culture, very vibrant every 100 kilometers, between that is where the racial problem is. So where do we draw the line? Do we choose to, is integration a good thing or a bad thing? Because to integrate, the ethnicity will have to have pride in themselves. And when you push that pride leads to you thinking yourself to be superior to others and not empathizing with anyone else. So I'm sure this may not have a definitive answer, but I would like to know the opinion.
I would like to say that I'm not like a professional, like they all have like producers and everything set. I have nothing like that at all. And I think I'm actually kind of profiting out of the fact that we don't exist in the country right now, you know, like Tibet, and we are kind of like everywhere but nowhere in a way. And for me, the censorship is or like the, like she uses this word which is nice, like the self-inspection or the police,
self-censorship.
And also my own, I'm scared of my, not scared, I think not comfortable with my own people maybe. Like if I want to start, write something and say something, I'm like, oh, what will they think? How will they see it? So this is my only, like I don't have to worry about selling and, you know, somebody else coming over. And so I kind of like try to, like she says, metaphor and all that.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know if I'm doing that, but using that point and try to be like personal and not political in a way, because I know that my first film, when I did it, I sort of manipulated myself or say like, oh, if I make it a Tibet issue and all that, I will probably be liked by my own people, right?
Yeah.
So I kind of got into that zone, right? And this one I thought that, okay, whatever they say, I'll accept it and I'll do it as I feel and I won't get into that thing. Mm. So for me, right now, we don't have a country. But at the same time, I really want myself or to express myself as more as possible. You know, one day if we have our own country and everything, I don't know what kind of rule or what kind of thing will be there, and what kind of like all these people have a country, but they have their, you know, like limits and rules, and I don't know what we will have. But in a way, we are everywhere, and we learn from other countries, we learn from other things, and we take it. And Tibetan people are very good at that. Like the Buddhism, it's from India, right? We are not Tibetan, not Buddhist. Like Buddha was not born in Tibet, so we have now we are known as the Buddhists, right? From how we have conserved it, and also the food and many other things. And I hope that, you know, like in that way we will be able to get the best sort of example of government rules, or, you know, from a good country, and I don't know. So I'm hoping for that, actually.
Okay, I think it's been a really fascinating discussion, and your question is, you know, something that we all need to think about. You know, is it better to have a multicultural society with all the problems that throws up? Or, you know, or is ethnic cleansing and homogeneity of society actually the way to go? I don't think it is going to go in that direction, the way the world is going now.
We all want.
So thank you all for bearing with us. Thank you all the panelists. I think it's been really amazing.